Historically, this collapse of the Sumerian Empire, the moment when the Anunnaki abandoned the place like migrating birds, immediately follows the historical ransacking of Babylon by Jehovah. The story of the Tower of Babel. It fits the time frame absolutely. The story of Genesis relates to us that the people were hitherto said by Jehovah to be very good, but were suddenly punished because of a very strange transgression that actually had never been previously described at all. This transgression was that they all spoke the same language, we're told, so God decided to confuse the language. In actual fact, their language was, of course, Sumerian, the oldest written language on earth. Their transgression, however, wasn't that they spoke the true language, the same language. In fact, Genesis tells us the transgression. And the transgression is that Jesus punished the people who had said, "Let us build a city and a tower whose top may reach to heaven, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad." Well, that's not actually made too much sense to anybody. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad. For that, Babel and the tower were smashed and the people were overrun. What the text actually used was a different word, and the word it used was Shem. Shem, from whence comes Shuma, Shema. "Let us make a Shem," it said, "lest we be scattered abroad." And there we suddenly discover that the word Shem was translated to name. Now there is a reason for that, and we'll come back to it. It does have a bearing on the word name. But in actual fact, the word Shem came from the term shamin, which means heaven. It derives from a root word shama, which means that which is highward. A shem was in fact a monument, a highward monument, in one of its respects, a highward monument. A shem was actually the monument from which we eventually obtained those things which we call church spires and steeples. The conical, tall, highward monument, the Shem. However, a Shem was kind of more than that, because they weren't just big Shems, they were little Shems. And a Shem was highward, and the full name of the word was Shemana. Shemana. And Shemana meant a highward firestone. Highward firestone. Firestone is the Shemana bit that's Anna. Shem is highward, firestone is Anna. When firestone isn't described as firestone, what else does it mean? Anna is translated in Sumerian and Akkadian to a bright, shining metal. So Shemana, a highwood firestone, is a highwood, or high, bright, shining metal. The use of the word Shem is apparent in the names of people of the era. There was a god called Shemesh, the brother of Queen Inanna. Shemesh was called the Shining One, Shemesh. Shem always meant shining when it was applied to people or metallic things. Otherwise, it meant highwood. Highwood, shining, meant the same things. It meant something in a high state, something that gleamed, something that was powerful. So back to Babylon. They're about to build their Shem to save themselves from being scattered abroad. But what do the historical documents tell us against what the Bible tells us about this bit of the story? What they tell us, we've just heard, is that hordes of invaders came into the country. Amorites came in, Elamites came in. All of these people suddenly invaded and sacked the country at that time. God says in the Bible, Jehovah, God, "I shall come down and confound the language of all the earth." So, what was this magical powder that was for the Israelites? Is there a way of transforming metallic gold into a white powder, like Moses was said to have done? Well, in actual fact, there is. Because to make gold, it said you must take gold. And white powder, it said, was gold. And the starting point for gold is gold. So to make the white powder, you begin with gold. And the story goes round in a circle, and we move into a particular avenue of early alchemical practice. Gold is noble, they said. Gold is truth. through the regular use of the Anunnaki star fire, which was itself called the gold of the gods, the recipients were said to have moved into the realms of heightened awareness, consciousness, because of the inherent melatonin and serotonin. This was the realm of advanced enlightenment, which they called the Sharon, the plane of the orbit of light, and the star fire was said to be the route to the light. So, this mundane, heavy darkness can be transferred into light, into gold. And this became the root of alchemical practice thereafter. So, we have white powder, we have shewbread. What does that remind us of? It reminds us of something else in the Bible, another strange food substance that suddenly appeared at around the time of Moses. The people knew not what it was, it said. They thought it was snowing. This divine and wonderful food, what was it, they said? What was it? It is manna. In actual fact, the interesting thing about the word manna is that if one looks back at the earliest documents, we find that even what is it, manna, is an abbreviation of Shemanna. Shemanna, remember, was Highwood Firestone. What is it? It is Highwood Firestone. What is Highwood Firestone? When the children of Israel saw it, they said to one another, it is manna, because they knew not what it was. Moses said, this is the bread. The manna is then described to be white. The manna is then said to be like snow. The manna is said to taste sweet, like honey. And they called it bread. When the Ark of the Covenant was completed, Moses' brother Aaron was said to have placed an omer full of manna into the ark. And the New Testament book of Revelations continues the story. It says, to him that cometh, I will give the hidden manna. I will give the what stone, and in the stone will be a new name written, which no one knoweth except he who receiveth it. Much later, in Grail lore, in European Grail lore, and we're now moving forward to the 1200s, comes this quote. Around the end of the stone is an inscription in letters, and it tells the name and the lineage of those, be they maids or boys. Those are they who make the journey to the Grail, and nobody can read the inscription on the stone except they whom it is for, and then it vanishes. So there's a direct parallel here between something from the Book of Revelation and something from Grail lore of the Middle Ages, and it refers to a stone, and it refers to whiteness, it refers to a name. And the word Shem, if we remember, was translated into name. Let us make a name, lest we be scattered abroad. In actual fact, name is equivalent because of its use here. Highwood Firestone Shemanna was manna, and this was associated with a name, and the name was the lineage. The name was the Grail. The pharaohs, in their travels, as written in the Book of the Dead and in other European archives, keep telling us that at each stage of a pharaoh's journey, he is still asking, what is it? What is it? Shemanna. It is the manna, it is the gold, it is the white food. In the alchemical tradition, something called the philosopher's stone is said to be that which translates base elements into gold. This is deemed to be the case in the higher metallurgical sense, and also in the spiritual sense of enlightenment, moving the mundane person into a higher state of being, transferring his lead into gold. So instead of taking the stuff, they produced the first manufactured drug, the first supplement. It actually charged your glands to make them produce more of these hormones. And what was that made out of? It was made out of metal. It was manna. It was shemanna. It, what is it? It was shefa food. It was whatever you like to call it, shewbread. But it was made out of gold, and it was made out of platinum. And tests have now proved the difference between the two. There is no doubt whatsoever that the old records were correct. Because when they tell us what the white gold did as against what the red gold did, this now proves out scientifically that the red gold, the gold, affects the pineal gland absolutely. The white gold, the platinum group metals, affect the pituitary gland. By taking the substances from both, you will be producing both melatonin and serotonin. Serotonin feeds the pineal and produces more melatonin. So by taking both of them, you are going to end up taking from the plant of life. And just as Jehovah said in Genesis, behold, you're becoming like one of us.